The morning sun shines on the gleaming hide of a muscular ranch horse. The aroma of bacon and coffee drifts from the wood cook stove at a cow camp. Silver spurs jingle as the men and women of the West get set for another day in the saddle. From the heart of Canada's finest ranching country, this is the Spirit of the West with rancher and horse trainer Hugh McLennan and his collection of music, poetry, and conversations with the folks who live and work with horses and cattle in the Spirit of the West.
Sometimes in a day's ride or a day's work on a ranch, it's not unusual to run into situations that nobody would believe unless they'd been there. Ted Wheat ranches near Vermilion, Alberta, and a wild cow of his wound up way up in his hayloft, and he figured he needed to call for help.
Thought, rather than phone him and explain this on the phone, have him not believe me and not come over, I'll just drive over. He'll realize this is truth.
The rest of that adventure comes out of the vault today with several more real-life stories like this one from Don Howard.
And it's about 10 feet down there, and he could not crawl out of there no how.
Oh, man. So your horse is up above, and you and the calf are down below.
Yeah.
The Rangeland News has an item about Canada being blamed for the drought in the western United States,
causing record-high temperatures and wildfires in Canada.
The devastating wildfires across North America bring back memories of 2003, when we had two different evacuation orders at our place. And in September, when things settled down, the late Mike Pulallo wrote a deeply moving poem, and he sent the words to Gary Fjellgaard.
And then, standing in the ashes, saying, "We can build again." I mean, that's pretty powerful stuff. So it certainly inspired the song, Raw Courage.
And you will hear the song and the poem today. Don Howard with a newborn calf, both of them stuck in a 10-foot-deep gully, and you'll hear how his horse helped them get out of it. Right after a guy retired from rodeo 10 years ago, and now he's back at it, this is Tony Lunderbull.
She was definitely a looker. Don't think he hadn't noticed. Just cause he was 83, his eyes were bright and focused. When he saw these two young bucks with that mount of coup, he said, "You better listen close. You need to hear the truth. Well, you call yourself a cowboy, well, you got a ways to go. 'Cause any real cowboy will take it nice and slow. If you want to catch that pretty gal, then listen to what I say. Takes a lot of time and patience when it's done the cowboy way." Billy watched this young cowboy try to saddle up a horse. Billy was getting nervous, he was using too much force. The old man seen it coming long before he got a seat. He laughed and shook his head as he landed in a heap. "Well, you call yourself a cowboy, well, you got a ways to go. 'Cause any real cowboy will take it nice and slow. If you want to break that cayuse, then listen to what I say. Takes a lot of time and patience when it's done the cowboy way. Well, today's generation has really gone astray. Wish we could all get back to the good old cowboy way. Well, you call yourself a cowboy, well, you got a ways to go. 'Cause any real cowboy will take it nice and slow. If you really want to live this life, then listen to what I say. Takes a lot of time and patience when it's done the cowboy way. It takes time and patience when it's done the cowboy way."
We were enjoying the January sunshine aboard the cruise ship a couple of hundred miles north of Puerto Vallarta, and I was standing there with Lorne Ray, Russ Peake, and Don Howard.
Here's a treasure house of cowboy wisdom and ranching experience over the years. Yeah, man. Don and Russ and Lorne, gosh. Right, I got your book, Don, and yes. I read it from cover to cover, and that can't all be true.
I think there's only one little paragraph in there that isn't true.
Oh, which one is that?
That's that one where that brother dragged that horse upstairs by the tail and put it in the bathtub.
That was embellished.
To get even with his older brother.
I can't remember all the stuff I read, but can you take me back to there was a calf that had fallen down into a, it a well or something?
No, it was in a deep canyon in a coulee in a pasture, and it was down. I couldn't find him for the longest time, but I could hear the cow bawling, and I seen she had a full udder. She hadn't been nursed on for 3-4 days. I was about to give up, and I heard the faint bawl of a calf somewhere. So I searched for hours, couldn't find that darn thing. Till finally my horse was going down one path and I could see it was looking or knew something that I didn't know. And I crawled around in the brush and here there was a little cavity and it had fallen down into a wash that was about 10 feet deep and muck in the bottom. Yeah.
So he was still alive?
He was still alive. He was ganted up and all covered with mud, so I'd jumped down in the, threw a rope down, dallied on the horse and threw a rope down in there. And
from your saddle horn?
Yeah. Put hobbles on the horse and then I couldn't get out of the cave after I put the rope around the neck and the front leg so it wouldn't choke it. So I thought, well, I'll back the horse.
So you put the rope around the calf's front legs?
Front leg and neck.
Yeah. And you're down in the hole with the calf now?
Yeah, I'm down. It's about 10 feet down there, and you could not crawl out of there no how.
Oh, man. So your horse is up above, and you and the calf are down below.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cool.
Well, Don must have survived because he and Carmen were along with us on the cruise, and, of course, Don had his fiddle there, too. And we'll find out what happened next when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. Now it's back to the bunch of great stories we heard on our recent cruise in the Sea of Cortez. Don Howard had ridden far and wide looking for a missing newborn calf, and his horse caught the scent, and they found the calf at the bottom of a hole 10 feet deep. So Don hobbled his horse, tied his rope to the saddle horn, and slid down into the hole, put the loop around the calf, and then he realized that it was impossible to climb back out of that hole.
Then I couldn't get out of the cave after I put the rope around the neck and the front leg so it wouldn't choke it. So I thought, well, I'll back the horse.
So you put the rope around the calf's front legs?
Front leg and neck.
Yeah. And you're down in the hole with the calf now?
Yeah, I'm down. It's about 10 feet down there, and you could not crawl out of there no how.
Oh, man. So your horse is up above, and you and the calf are down below.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. So I thought, well, the only way to get out of here is if I can back the old horse up. So I hollered at him to back up.
And he had hobbles on.
Yeah, but he walked. He got back enough, threw a few waves at him with the rope. And he backed up enough, and I pulled the calf up just enough so I could get up on the calf's head with my muddy boots, and my head was just sticking out the hole then.
Oh, my gosh.
And I was able to crawl out. I didn't take me long to get out of there once I had that footstool.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought of skeletons and bones and caves.
Yeah.
You know.
I thought that, you know, in 10 years from now, somebody would come along and all they'd find is your skeleton and the calf skeleton down in the hole.
That's right.
And your horse is gone.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah. There's a pile of adventures. You had some characters that you dealt with at times around there. The shades of the old West with some of that stuff.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you know, well, you get to meet a lot of interesting people through your life, really, you do. Yeah.
The book's selling well, I think.
We've sold over 1,000 copies. We haven't even tried.
Yeah.
We never did put it on the market.
If you'd like to buy Don's book for yourself or as a gift for your friends, you can call Don at 403-823-7978. That's 403-823-7978. Next, it's the story of a young cowboy on a long trail drive, taking several hundred horses from Alberta down into Sweetgrass, Montana, after this fine song from Kevin Davis.
Have you ever heard the sound of hoofbeats in the dirt? Have you ever listened to a cowboy sing at work? Have you ever heard the sounds of a gathering fall? Oh, that lonesome coyote call. Have you ever watched the sunrise while sitting in a saddle, or look down from a hilltop at a valley full of cattle? Have you ever seen the sight of an eagle as he flies in that big wide open sky? Some things in this old world just don't have a price. A lot of folks are walking around unhappy with their life. And I know it's the simple things that God has made for me. So cowboy, but I'll be. I've rode the Rocky Mountains, Lord, they almost touch the sky. I've heard the bull elk bugle in the aspens up on high. I lay down on my stars above, and I thank God for the life I love. Some things in this old world just don't have a price. A lot of folks are walking around unhappy with their lives, but I know the simple things that God has made for me. So cowboys, what I'll be. I know it's the simple things that God has made for me. So cowboys, what I'll be.
Among the fine folks that were cruising with us, we had our cruising cowboy band, of course, consisting of Don Howard and Reg Evans with the twin fiddles, Ed Peek on guitar and vocals, and we also had the privilege of visiting with Ed's brother, Russ.
Yeah. Russ, your brother was telling me that you were involved in a lot of interesting things in the early ranching days and some big horse drives, was there?
Yeah, I went with my uncles from Hanna to Sweetgrass, Montana one year. It was in either 50 or 51. There was a railroad strike in Canada, so we had to trail them to Sweetgrass to ship them out.
Wow.
And that was 10 or 11 years old then. It was quite a trip.
How many horses?
About 500.
My gosh.
490 or something, I think it was.
Yeah. And how many riders?
I think there was four of us, four or five.
That's all?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
500 horses?
Yeah.
And how many days did that take?
Well, we were probably big end of 2 weeks, but we held up on the Milk River just north of Sweetgrass, waiting for the train to come. So we spent 3 or 4 days just holding them there.
Oh yeah.
So we're probably all in total it was 2 weeks from the time we left Hanna until we loaded them out, something like that.
And you just camp along the way?
Yeah. Well, my uncle had a little holiday trailer, and a couple of us slept in there. And I was small enough I could sleep on the front seat of the truck.
Oh, man. And what year was this?
50 or 51. 50 I can't remember 51. Which one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it wasn't a horse-pulled chuck wagon and a cook.
Oh, no,
a
no,
like
no,
that.
No.
So what about your meals? Like, how did you...
Well, just whenever my uncle showed up with the trailer, which wasn't very damned often. That's when we
ate. Feed you then.
Yeah, he'd feed us then.
You remember the horse you rode, or did you ride several different ones?
Actually, I rode, the horses I rode were going to the can. They were still good horses, but we only took two home. It was two that my uncles were riding. The rest were all went to the, but they were, you know, good horses, usable horses yet. Wow. They had a little age on them, 12, 14, 15 maybe, but still, today would have been good usable horses. Just went to the can.
And after that was done, and they were all delivered, and you're in Sweetgrass, how'd you get back?
Well, we, my uncle had a, came with a truck and hauled the two horses in, and I guess, I went back with my two uncles and myself.
In the truck?
In the truck, yeah.
With the horses, in the truck?
Two horses, yeah.
Oh, for God's sake.
And those were the days before, nobody had a horse trailer much then, or a stock trailer. It was just stock racks on your half ton.
Right after the break, another amazing story from the vault about a wild cow that got into Ted Wheat's hayloft, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West.
Stories from the vault, from the Spirit of the West. This is where we dig deep for some of the most amazing stories from the folks who bring some heartwarming, knee-slapping, spellbinding episodes.
It was a great gathering of young hopefuls and seasoned hands, the first annual Lakeland College Working Cowboy Competition in Vermilion, Alberta. Billy and I were invited by Bill Conrad, the program head, and it was a thoroughly enjoyable weekend. I even got to do a presentation, tell stories, and recite cowboy poetry from horseback in the arena. On Sunday morning, Bill invited a group of neighboring ranchers over for breakfast, and the Spirit of the West mobile microphone picked up some of the stories as they made their way onto the air when we got home, including Ted Wheat and this story about a cow in his hayloft.
I had an Angus cow that was kind of feisty, and she had had a calf that I drug into the barn. So I brought the calf in, and the cow follows me in, and she was pretty upset about everything going on. So I figured, well, I better just leave things alone and let her settle down in the box stall. So I just locked the gate and shut out the lights and left, and I left that there till morning. When I came back out, it's kind of dark in the barn, and it's got little corners, and she's as black as the ace of spades. So I'm thinking, well, I'll just go see if the calf did get up and suck or what happened. And I go back there and have a look, and I don't really see the cow. And I think, well, maybe she's in the corner lying down. And I look seriously, and I realize that cow's not in the box stall, just the calf. And the gate's still hanging on the hinges, so I start to wonder, well, where is she? Because she was kind of mad when I left her. And so I'm looking behind my back, and I'm looking in all the corners, and all of a sudden I hear what I call very large pigeon sounds from the roof. And so as soon as I thought, gosh, those are big pigeons, I thought, gosh, that's probably not a pigeon. And sure enough, there she is standing there looking down at me. And she's still not really any quieter than she was the night before. She's, in fact, maybe a little more upset. So what I actually had to do is kind of tease her from another angle and get her to face off, and then work my way around really wide and quiet, and then scurry down the stairs, and then I went in and had coffee.
Flick it over. With a cow somehow trapped up in his hayloft, he decided to consult with his neighbor, Ron Hoffman.
I thought, rather than phone him and explain this on the phone, have him not believe me and not come over, I'll just drive over and he'll realize this is truth. So I go in and start having coffee, and I said to him something like, I think I need some help this morning. So Ron came over and we got a tranquilizer, because first of all, we couldn't get near her very much. She's pretty mad. And so we kind of, I forget what we did, we pulled her down.
Roping in the loft.
Yeah, roping in the loft.
Cows in the loft.
Healing them. I remember Ron jumping on her and kind of trying to hold her down. So we swing these doors open, we put a chain on her front feet and got the front end loader up there close to the door and hooked her up and backed out. And as she came out, lift the front end loader, and Ron was supposed to hold on to her to stabilize her.
Oh, yeah.
With that lariat. But he actually just about came through the door.
On the end of the rope.
I think he let go of the chicken. So he was holding on, and then all of a sudden I see him coming to the door and then let go or something. And the old cow is like a pendulum out
swinging
there.
Just, on the bucket.
Yeah, just yeah. Swinging. Yeah. Then we just let her down gently and undid her and walked away and went for coffee. And she, I think in the end she appreciated it.
And there's a sad part to that story. Bill Conrad suffered a devastating stroke a few years ago, and he passed away not that long ago. And he was a great guy. Not only is Dave Stamey a superb musician, singer, songwriter, and a charismatic performer on stage, he is prolific. Seems to write songs almost as often as Ivan Danes does. Here's another one of his newer ones called Runaway Horse.
He's got a house on the hill. He's got a head on his shoulders. He's done real well. It's what they all say. He drives a brand new truck. Folks respect him. He knows he should be thankful every day. But in the long dark nights, he lies there wondering, is this everything life's supposed to be? And a cold, cold panic tries to grab him. He wants to jump up, bust through the gate, and go running free. Like a runaway horse, jumping fences, tearing up the country, trying to get away. Running scared, running blind, ripping right through the wind like a runaway horse. Ah, she's got a good heart. She's got a home and family. A man who loves her, kids who need her so. Ah, she had some dreams, but they never quite found her. If she has any regrets, you never know. But in the long dark night, there's a voice inside her saying if she don't start now, she never will. And a cold, cold panic tries to grab her. She wants to jump up, bust through the gate, and run for the hills. Like a runaway horse, jumping fences, tearing up the country, trying to get away. Running scared, running blind, ripping right through the wind like a runaway horse. Oh, it's always there, deep inside you. The howl of a wolf, the cry of a child. And it rattles your heart like a bird in the willows. It's always there and always wild. And in the long dark night, you can hear it calling. Sounds so loud, it sounds so real. And you just want to run in a cold, cold panic. And you swear you feel the world nipping at your heels. Like a runaway horse, jumping fences, tearing up the country, trying to get away. Running scared, running blind, ripping right through the wind like a runaway horse. Ripping right through the wind like a runaway horse.
The Rangeland News from the Spirit of the West, a roundup of issues and events from the world of agriculture.
At the top of page one, it says, well, I guess now Canada is being blamed for the stubborn, lengthy drought in much of the agricultural areas of the western U.S. And gee, I thought it was always El Nino.
If your crops are not doing well right now because of over a month of no rain in many places, don't blame El Nino in the equatorial Pacific Ocean. USDA meteorologist Brad Rippey says the real culprit in this case is a lot closer to home.
A extremely stubborn atmospheric block of high pressure situated across northern Canada.
Big and powerful enough to change the weather thousands of miles away here in the U.S.
And that effectively keeps cold fronts from reaching the Midwest or the Northeast. It keeps tropical moisture from working its way up from the south, and it serves as almost a complete block on rainfall reaching some of the nation's key agricultural areas. And until that block breaks down, we will not see appreciable rain.
So how long do these blocking high-pressure systems usually last?
1 to 2 months.
This one's been causing havoc for at least a month, not just blocking moisture to the U.S., but causing record-high temperatures and wildfires in Canada. Gary Crawford for the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
A research team from Texas Tech's Davis College of Agricultural Sciences and Natural Resources has received a $650,000 grant aimed at improving beef quality by taking a closer look at the cellular mechanisms that affect the final product that one day hits your grill. The improvement of beef quality and the production of beef that will consistently score in the upper range of quality grades will allow farmers to target branded beef programs, thus increasing carcass value and profitability for beef operations, according to the researchers. The three-year-old project is titled Unraveling Molecular and Cellular Mechanisms Underlying Intramuscular, Subcutaneous, and Visceral Adipose Tissue Growth in Beef Cattle. Well, I didn't think I could get through all that. Top grillers know that intramuscular fat, which is known as marbling, in the beef business is responsible for beef tenderness and flavor. Without fat, beef is dry and has little flavor. As a result, accumulation of the fat in the muscle is the primary determination of beef quality grade. However, a challenge the beef industry faces is how to improve marbling without leading to excessive fat accumulation in other parts of the animal. Manitoba Agriculture is giving ranchers and farmers a little over 1 month to provide feedback on proposed changes to Crown land leases and permits. The Department of Agriculture started to modernize the ACL in 2017 and added new stipulations in 2019, and these additional proposals would help further modernize the program that sees producers lease land for agricultural uses like grazing, haying, or cropping. And Manitoba farmers have until July 17th to submit their opinions, and the amendments will allow lease terms to be extended from 15 years to 20 years for leaseholders that practice good land management, broaden transfer rights, implement third-party appraisals for improvements, apply to set times for forage productivity assessments, and expand eligibility to Indigenous organizations. And those in favor of creating a federal right-to-repair law say the government should avoid shaping such legislation according to the wishes of special interest lobbyists as Ottawa gets set to launch consultations on this one. Ottawa signaled in its March budget that it would study the need for legislation to ban the sale of products that aren't intended to last and reinforce consumers' ability to repair the home appliances and electronics they buy. And Elisa Santavani, an assistant professor at Western University, said a national right-to-repair rules would be critical in the agriculture, healthcare, and consumer goods sectors that often face restrictions on third-party repair technicians. And a bill introduced last week by Quebec's justice minister would ban the sale of products whose obsolescence is planned and require repair services be available at a reasonable price. Ah, I always thought they built them with planned obsolescence. Next regular cattle sale at the Kamloops Yards of the BC Livestock Co-op will be July the 18th, July 20th, a regular sale in Williams Lake, and July 21st, regular sale in Vanderhoof. And you can get all the information and see the sales live at bclivestock.bc.ca. Meanwhile, at the Innisfail Auction Market, Innisfail, Alberta, regular cattle sales every Wednesday. And now, if you got yearlings to market, give Danny, Mark, or Dwayne a call at 1-800-710-3166 and get more details at InnisfailAuctionMarket.com. Now, the final item. When the wind was howling the other day and there was a strong aroma coming in the cracks around the door, I kind of wondered what was going on. The other night when Billy left some scraps out on the front step for Bandit, our cow dog,
She checked to see if they were cleaned up. She opened the door, and what she saw gave her quite a start. A very pretty black critter with a wide white stripe up its back and a big bushy tail was busy cleaning up the scraps. And that skunk has been making him or herself at home around here for quite a while now. And when the windstorm came up, it blew the fragrance right into my little studio here, and it reminds me very much of the guy who crossed a computer with a skunk. And what he got was a stinking know-it-all. And that's the Rangeland News.
Coming up on the Urban Saddles and Western Wear, horse training file, some ideas to help a young green colt ease into cattle and ranch work, when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. When a colt is beginning his higher education, and it includes working cattle in various situations, there are a few things I like to do to make it easier for him, and that's coming right up on the Urban Saddles and Western Wear horse training file right after this. Can you imagine 20 days of luxury accommodation, no cooking, cleaning, feeding, or chores? The 2024 Spirit of the West Cruise offers that and so much more. Our group will fly to Buenos Aires, Argentina on February the 2nd, 2024. Tour the city and tour an Argentine cattle ranch. Then board the Sapphire Princess and see ports of call like Montevideo, Uruguay, the Falkland Islands, and many more South American ports of call. Around Cape Horn and back to Santiago, Chile, and fly home on February the 20th. And get this. The big bonus for this cruise is the excursion package that includes all shore excursions along the way. A great chance to visit with fellow Spirit of the West cruisers, and you know we all have so much in common. Your hosts will be the official Spirit of the West support crew, Mark and Kathy McMillan, and booking on this great adventure will help us keep the Spirit of the West on the air. For all the details, just call 1-800-530-0131 and see our cruise page at hugh-mcclennan.com. From a radiator cap to an engine block, BZTractorParts.com is your source for whatever you need to keep that essential implement in top shape. Specializing in quality new replacement parts for agricultural tractors, Massey Ferguson, Ford, John Deere, David Brown, Case, International Harvester, Universal Deutz Leyland, Landini, Oliver Fiat, Alice, Zetor, White, and a lot more. If you don't have internet, just call Mark at 250-395-0960. One click or one call, and the parts will be on their way. BZTractorParts.com.
Now it's time for the Horse Training File, brought to you by Irvine Tack and Western Wear, Canada's largest Western store.
Everyone knows that Irvine Tack and Western Wear is the place for Western Wear boots and saddles. Irvine's is also your go-to for animal health and wellness, livestock, poultry, and of course, horses. You'll find feed, supplements, first aid supplies too, plus a great selection of grooming products to get your horses ready for show, rodeo, and stampede season. Animal health and wellness. Irvine Tack and Western Wear, exit 305 off Highway 2 by Crossfield.
Canada's largest Western store.
Some of the appropriate assignments for a green horse getting an introduction to ranch work. Riding in the drag with a group of quiet cattle. And that works for some colts, but a lot of them won't be very patient at the slow pace, and they may get a little bit antsy, being held back. On the other hand, it works best most of the time, of course, to let the cattle set the pace, so in some cases it's maybe not the best place for a green colt. Sometimes when a group of cattle have been gathered, a couple of riders hold the bunch while somebody else rides out and looks for more. The better job for the green colt is usually the one that'll keep him the busiest, and that is generally heading out and looking for more cattle, while the seasoned horses wait with the herd. And when we're doing a bigger move, say 50 yearlings or pairs or more, we'll usually have a rider on the point, a couple of riders on the drag, and depending on the kind of trail, at least one rider about halfway back in the herd. And if the country's wide open, you might need a couple of riders on swing, but where the trails are steep and narrow with heavy timber on each side, often one rider can handle this pivotal spot, and that's not a bad place for a green colt. If the cattle drop off behind him, it's no big deal. The riders in the drag should pick him up. And he gets used to pushing cattle from behind, and more important, maybe, he gets used to having a lot of cattle coming up behind him.
And for Urban Saddles and Western Wear, that's the horse training file. Our horses look forward to that daily feeding of Hoffman's horse ration. Every day it keeps them fit and looking good. And to find out what's in it and why it works, just go to hoffmanshorseproducts.com. My wife Billy was raised almost within sight of a little ranching town called Tees, Alberta. And Ray Baird has a song about the famous Tees Stampede.
Bucking chutes are loaded, calf pens being filled, grand entry standing by, waiting to be called in. Fans in the bleachers, judges ready to go. This is the start of the Tees Rodeo. Cowgirls dressed in Sunday best, looking pert and cute, guide their horses round the barrels, make a perfect clover loop. Now the seconds really count, a dash to the finish line. Check the weights, the winner, who has the fastest time. Ducking wrong snorting bulls, the clanging of the gates, dust in the arena, from the calves the ropers chase. Troop boss says get ready, for your stock will be turned loose. There ain't no time for fooling round, gotta keep the fans amused. Cowboy country, beef dinners are in demand. An open pit barbecue served up behind the stand. An all night preparation, keep the fire burning bright. We'll drink a toast to the breakfast host and the crew that worked all night. A cabaret on Saturday, the halls filled to the brim. Band with Sally Goodman, she loves her rodeo man. We dance till the sun is up, and when the chores are done, we get back to the arena and we start all over again. Bucking broad, snorting bulls, the clanging of the gates, dust in the arena from the calves the ropers chase. Shoe boss says get ready, or your stock will be turned loose. There ain't no time for fooling around, gotta keep the fans of you. Gate, dust in the arena, from the calves the ropers chase. Shoe boss says get ready, or your stock will be turned loose. There ain't no time for fooling around, gotta keep the fans of you. No, there ain't no time for fooling around, gotta keep the fans of you.
Thinking back on Russ Peek's story of that great horse drive to Sweetgrass, Montana, and all those horses, gee, it's sad, because some of them might have made really good mounts. And got me thinking about a lot of the folks I ride with and have ridden with for many, many years, and so many of them have had special horses in their lives. Jonathan Field and his famous Gelding Hal. John Lyons and his happy, bright Zip. Brent Trout and Checkmate. Ken Dalgleish, my neighbor, and his great mare Rudy, a horse I started for him, and she died last month at the age of 36. Vic Piva and his great gelding Sambo, another neighbor Bob Brash, and DJ, so many more. And it fits right into the sentiments of this song from Gary Pratt.
They brought them hundreds ago. Natives, they used them to hunt buffalo. be a companion to ride with the wind. This horse, he is my friend. Boys, this horse, he is my friend. Tends his ears back, sets keen eyes, tall withers for tack. Puts me right there to throw out my rope. This horse, he is my friend. Boys, this horse, he is my friend. Just watching them graze when the sun's going down, ready for feed in the morn. Stands quiet for saddle with work yet to come. Trust that is earned and not born. Us that is earned and not born. A life too short for us that care. The older ones teach new bulls from the mares. You look in their eyes, look in their soul. This horse, he is my friend. He is my friend. He's watching them graze when the sun's going down. He's ready for feed in the morn. There's white horse saddle with work yet to come. Trusting that is earned and not born. Trust that is earned and not born. He's watching them graze when the sun's going down. He's ready for feed in the morn. White horse saddle with work yet to come. Trust that is earned and not born. Trust that is earned and not born.
Memories of 2003 with Gary Fjellgaard when the Spirit of the West continues right after this. Welcome back to the Spirit of the West. The wildfires of 2003 overwhelmed the country. They burned across the U.S. and Canada, destroying homes, rangeland, hundreds of cattle, hundreds of miles of fences, industry, and hopes and dreams. Out of the ashes, though, we were able to see the incredible resilience of the human spirit. If you live in the city, fire insurance is taken for granted. But in remote rural areas of the West, fire insurance sometimes just is not available. And the people of the land have come together in an amazing way to try and do what the insurance companies couldn't do and governments entangled in red tape can't get started. Cowboy poet Mike Pulallo sent a copy of his poem called Courage to me shortly after he wrote it, along with permission to recite it. And Gary Fjellgaard also received a copy of these words. The West is creation's best, sculpted by ice, wind, and fire. Her children made to match the land, twisted rawhide and barbed wire. The half moon hangs blood red over a valley choked with smoke, stillness beyond quiet. No night bird or cricket sings, as nature waits in silent dread to see what tomorrow brings. Have you ever seen true courage? It's not the brave boasts of fighting men. It's the whisper of a woman standing in the ashes, saying, "We shall build again." And those words from the pen of cowboy poet and rancher Mike Pulallo is now a song from Gary Fjellgaard, who's on the line from his home on Gabriel Island.
It must have been kind of emotional for you, I would think, just putting the song together.
Well, when Mike Pulallo sent me the original poem, Courage, and some of the lines he had in that, the half moon hangs blood red, and then standing in the ashes, saying we can build again. I mean, that's pretty powerful stuff. So, it certainly inspired the song, Raw Courage. So, you know, once I had it written, I thought, well, this thing is no good to me just sitting here in a drawer or whatever, or just for me to perform myself. I've got to get this down on a CD of some kind to see if we can't do something good with the song. So it took on a life of its own, and everybody, all the musicians, the studio, everybody donated 100%, including 1,000 free copies for the, all went up to the North Thompson Relief Fund.
Flames dancing on the hills, half moon hangs blood red, the devil has been fed. Dry, it's never been so dry. The night never ends, and damn that shifting wind. Oh, we have seen raw courage, we've seen it in the eyes of all. On the line, and the love between a woman and a man, standing in the ashes saying we can build again. Oh, that's courage, raw courage. Oh, that's courage, raw courage. Standing in the ashes saying dawn, the battle rages on. Smoke, the valley's filled with smoke. Will we ever see the sun? And not till the battle's won. Oh, we have seen raw courage, we've seen it in the eyes of all. In the black and weary faces of those heroes on the line, and the love between a woman and a man, standing in the ashes saying we can build again. Oh, that's courage, raw courage. Oh, that's courage. Saying we can build again. Oh, that's courage, raw courage. Oh, that's courage, raw courage. Oh, that's courage. Raw courage. Oh, that's courage.
Thanks again for making the ride, and I sure hope you can join us right here next week at the same time. And as always, thanks to Mark and Kathy McMillan, our great support crew. Now, be sure to check the latest issue of Canadian Cowboy Country Magazine for all kinds of great reading and pictures, and you can subscribe online at CanadianCowboy.ca. Be sure to check out our YouTube channel for this show and many more from the past, with video and lots of videos of the Western Spirit Band and ranching scenes and much more. The links are on our website, hugh-mclennan.com. Till next week, I'm Hugh McLennan. Hope to see you down the trail somewhere real soon.